back of the London Ultra Cab this week. We have Colin. It was in a Young Lion Sound System from the early 80s, and also the TNT Rockers B-Boy crew. And it's great to have you in the back of the London cab. How you doing? You good?
Pleasure to be here, Steve.
And we finally meet. It's taken a while, but we've got there.
Totally.
No, listen, an absolute honour to have you in the back of the cab.
It's more of an honour for me, my friend, Steve.
Oh, thank
more
you.
More of an honour for me.
Thank you. But listen, right, you know the way it works. The first two questions I like to ask is, you know, where are you from and what was it like growing up as a kid?
Two Tin City.
Southwest.
I'm Southwest from Tooting Broadway, really. Tooting Broadway, that's where I come from. South London. And that's kind of really where I grew. Tooting Broadway, Ernest Bevin School.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you see, when I was in Ernest Bevin School, that was where kind of my whole B-boying career started.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'll talk to you a bit more about before that. But Ernest Bevin was where it started. And we did this book. And I promised you, Steve, that I was going to give you a present.
Yeah.
Right? So here's the present, and I'm going to bring it out. I don't know, you're driving, so just watch the road. But it's this.
No way.
Now that's
is that the original
That's the original book, Steve, and this is for you. This is the book that I was in.
Let me pull over. That's amazing. Can you hold it up to the camera? Yeah, yeah. Go right forward with it. And so that's called breakdancing.
That's called breakdancing.
And that come out in, when was that?
That's 85? Come out in 1984.
Oh, is it 84?
Yeah.
Wow.
And that's for you.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm gonna, well, listen, leave
oh,
it
yeah,
there.
Oh yeah, I can't give this to you, can I?
I'll
put it here. But this is for you. Now, let me just say something to you.
Can you sign that as well?
I'll sign it.
Yeah, yeah.
This is from my company, Each Teach.
Yeah.
And this is for you. And we are awarding this to you for the work that you're doing.
That's amazing.
So I went
Thank you so
I
much.
Went out and hunted, because I've got my own copy, I went and hunted a copy for you.
That means so much. And you know I've been after that book as well.
I know you have. That was the surprise.
No, listen, thank you so much.
No problem.
Right. Sort of, you blew me away a bit then. Right,
yeah,
So let's go back. So let's go back to the 70s, growing up as a kid. So
yeah.
What was it like?
For me, it was quite difficult, right? Because
yeah.
I come from South London, and at the particular time you're talking about when I was 8, 9, 10, I actually got into the music scene at very young, very, very, very young.
And what music was you into?
Reggae.
You was into the reggae, yeah.
Reggae, sound system. Reggae, soul as well a little bit,
yeah.
But it was mainly reggae. And I was a exuberant child, very, very exuberant, wanted to do everything and anything. So my sister's partner, he was in Young Lion Sound.
Right.
So when you say, when even, it's okay introducing me as being in it, but I wasn't in it per se. I used to MC for them, because when I MC'd for Young Lion, I was about 10. So I wasn't a member in it.
But you was down with.
But I MC'd for them quite a few times. So those days I was like 9, 10, 11. And if you can imagine being 9, 10, 11, being a good MC, my sister's boyfriend would sneak me out to go and MC at raves. And I'm like 9, 10.
What, like the reggae sort of
at
type raves?
Big clashes and all
big
of that.
Big clash, yeah.
Because you also had other young, but you never had many, right? So I was one of the young people that would go up on the mic, and the minute you heard a young boy, 9, 10, on the mic, little voice that could MC, you would tear down the place. So when I was young, I was a very, very good MC on the mic in regards to ragga sounds, reggae sounds. So that's how I kind of started off in the whole music scene.
So like you was into the toasting and the chatting?
Oh yeah, I was big time.
Can you remember some of the kind of clashes that you had?
Yes, I remember being there when...
Say some of the highlights.
So the highlight for me was when Young Lion clashed Stereograph, right? I think I must have been 11 or 12. And yeah, I just remember the clash was gonna happen. I remember my uncle coming down, telling me that, you know what, Colin, we need you. You know, imagine I'm 11, 12, and I remember saying, wow, you know, and I remember emceeing that night being 11, 12. And
what year was this, like early 80s or late 70s?
This would have most probably been...
Early 80s?
Early, maybe 81, 80. Yeah. This was the time when Saxon were massive. Saxon with all the Saxon crew, Smiley Culture, Tipper Ivory, all of them guys. So but they weren't big like they are now, they were just like a normal sound. Wasn't even the number one sound then.
Yeah.
In my eyes, it was like rather another sound from Brixton called Frontline or Young Lion or Just Shaka.
Yeah.
And Saxon were up there as well. I mean, Saxon went on to absolutely dominate as well, arguably. Dominate, but at that time they wasn't dominating, not then, not in my perception anyway.
And with your going back to like with the reggae sound, who was influencing you back then?
You mean artists?
Yeah, artists, yeah.
See, to me, who was influencing me was the because you're talking like when I was 10, 11. Right, so I wasn't really into the music per se, I was more into the MCs.
So did you have any MCs that you'd look up to and think?
Yes, yeah. Colonel Floxy, he was from a sound called Frontline.
Yeah, where was Frontline from?
Brixton,
right.
Yeah, and I called myself Floxy. So when I was an MC on the mic, first of all, I was called, I was called MC Colin.
Right, yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
Then I changed it to Floxy.
You wanted to get a bit more original?
Yeah, no, I wanted to get original at the start.
Yeah.
And then I changed it to Floxy.
To Floxy, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah,
and I changed it to Floxy, and that was my MC name when I used to chat on the mic. Yeah, so you see, the memories from them days were very, very difficult because what I used to do was rather I was an MC on the night or I was a dancer. So this is how I started off my dance career. So I was actually a skanker. So they would put on certain dub music.
The skanking was a dance, isn't it?
Oh, man, days, yeah.
I remember the skanking.
All right, so I was a skanker. And
you said get down and
then you would have battles, like MC battles, like in Bboying, and you would challenging skanking. So I was a skanker way before I was doing anything else. But this was when I was like 10, 9, 10, 11. And then obviously when they would do park jams, I remember one at Battersea Park where they would play sound and I would go up on stage, hundreds of people, and skank. Not just me, there would be other people in the sound, but he would do it like a show. They would bring on their skankers and people would just skank.
Where was that, in Battersea Park?
That's in Battersea Park.
When was this?
God, this would have been same time, 80s, 80, 81.
Yeah.
Because you'd have sound systems that would just string up and play the sound. But then again, keep it in mind, I was 10, 11. So, yeah. And so you see, the funny thing about my sound days is I think about those sound days like it was a long period of my life. But it wasn't. It was most probably about a year and a half, 2 years, max.
Yeah.
But obviously, the space of time in a child's life, it seems like years.
It's years and years, yeah. Whereas probably only like a year or two.
Exactly. So for me, it seems like years. But when I reflect on it,
probably only like 1 or 2 years.
1 or 2 years maximum. Yeah.
So how did you get into the hip hop then?
Well,
what was the first kind of electro or hip hop track you heard?
Well, you see, fancy. Now, before, you see, I've got to go from the reggae, which is the sound system days, then to the soul.
Because
what happened was you had a period where you had a lot of, for me, this is my perception, right? You had a lot of trouble with the reggae scene. There was, it was like what happened with the garage scene much later on. Like, lots of trouble, venues being closed down, you know, the whole So Solid phenomenon. Yeah, yeah. They're not allowed to DJ anywhere or have any shows. This what happened to reggae in the early 80s. And it was like, it was almost like if you went out to a reggae dance, you might get stabbed. So what happened was the soul came along, and then I got into the whole soul and jazz funk and all that kind of stuff. So I was actually a dancer anyway.
So you was doing that jazz, sort of jazz funk style dance as well?
Absolutely. So that, and that was at the same time kind of as I was skanking. So I was actually doing both at the same time, 9, 10, 11, 12. And then, and I was in my school, Ernest Bevin. And I'd always been a dancer. So when I used to, so talking about first year of Ernest Bevin school, so as far as I was concerned, I was a very competent dancer. At that time, when I was at school, nobody was dancing, right? So I was like, cool, no problem. But I used to see myself as a very competent dancer because I had done shows, being on stage from 9, 10, 11, right? So then what basically happened was the school, big up to Aston, Charlie, Chidi, Valentine, and what happened was these guys made a dance group. This was when I was about 12, 13, this is about 1982.
So is this before TNT?
Yeah, this is before TNT.
Yeah, yeah.
This is before TNT. This was at school, so I was about 12, 13. And they made up this crew, and this crew was called Groove Patrol. And it was in Ernest Bevin. So one day I was sitting in school and there was no b-boying then. None.
This is before breaking, isn't it?
This is before breaking.
So what was this, more like focusing on popping? Body
this is,
popping?
No, this is before popping.
Oh, robot.
This is robot.
That's the robot.
This
right.
is robot.
Yeah, yeah.
This is 1981.
Oh, right, it's 81, right. 81. Yeah, so it's the robot times. Yeah.
This is robot times, yeah, right? Yeah. And then what happened was I'm at school and these guys come on dancing. And they're doing robot, proper just robot on stage, right? 81, 82. And I'm watching, and I never forget my feeling of thinking, how dare they make up a crew without putting me in it, right? So they come up on school and everybody claps and everyone's cheering and all this kind of stuff. And I remember thinking, what? They never invited me. Now, I can tell you the reason why they never invited me, and I know now on reflection, was at this particular time, even though I was 10, 11, 12, imagine I'm with Chashaka, skanking for them, Young Lion, in all these kinds, so I was quite old for my age.
Yeah.
Which meant, subsequently, and I'm not proud of it, which is most probably the reason why I went on to work with young people, was I was a bit of a bully.
Yeah.
And I admit it. I do apologize.
Is your proper like ragga style?
Yeah. Right, so basically, well, because of that, when they made up this crew, what I subsequently found out was they didn't want me in the crew because I was a bit of a troublemaker. So I went to the head of the school, which is a guy called Mr. Cooper, head of music, and I went to him and I said, Mr. Cooper, can I be in the dance crew? And he said, I think you need to come at one of the lunch times. And these guys that made up the crew all knew me and all knew I was a good dancer. So I went there at one of the lunch times, I'll never forget, and I knocked on the door, and these guys remember this, and I knocked on the door, and this guy called Charlie Adewale, said that I needed to audition. He said I needed to audition. And I said to him, if any of you guys can beat me at dancing, I will not be in the crew. And I remember I battled them all.
And you beat everyone.
I can say it right now, I was, because you see, the difficult, this, here's the, what I'm gonna say to you, Steve, I had a massive advantage, because I'd been performing years before that, 2 years before that, I'd been skanking. So I was a performer from day dot. So when it came to battling and shows, I was already a performer. So obviously, some of those guys that were in the group had just started with Robot. I'd been doing Robot and Jazz Funk and all that. So obviously, rest is history, I got into the crew. Subsequently from that, the next year, 1982, we went in for this competition called the Summer Arts Festival. It was on ITV, and we had to go from preliminaries, school, national, and then it went on ITV. You can still get it now, and we won this competition.
Where was the competition?
The it was on ITV.
No, what was it, in the studio?
Yeah.
Right.
It was on the studio. It was nationwide. It was 1980. It was aired in 1983 on the Melvin Bragg Show. Just in case, I know we've got some people that will check this out. So check it out. Melvin Bragg, 1983, we won this competition. And we went on stage and we was doing Robot and we won the competition. And for our winning prize, we got to meet the Rocksteady crew. This was when Rocksteady, people will remember this, were performing at Olympia. This was when Rocksteady brought out the record. Hey, you, the Rocksteady crew. Yeah. And they were doing a national tour that was going German, everything. And for our winning prize, we met Rocksteady crew. We went up to their hotel. God, I forgot where it was. But all of us went there. But at that time, imagine it, we were still doing Robot. This is when I then saw, subsequently, very soon after that, this is when I saw Buffalo Girls. So
you did this is early 83.
This is early 83.
Yeah.
So this is when I first got into the whole breaking thing,
the whole B-boying
thing from then. But I was already a dancer that had performed one competitions nationally already. So then we as Groove Patrol, as my school crew, we went on to do lots of different shows. We went on BBC, we did lots of people remember the Royal Children's Variety Show.
Yeah,
we did the Royal Children's Variety Show. There was loads of them guys from Covent that was on it. I can't remember the person I remember who was on it was Yankee. I remember Flash being on it. There's been videos and clips on it, enough of them
was
guys.
Was Yankee beatboxing?
Yeah, no, he was dancing.
Oh, this is before the beatbox days, right?
Yes. This is before the beatbox days.
Because I was going to say, the beatbox days were probably around the 84-ish.
84.
Yeah.
This is before then. He was dancing. And lots of them guys, I can't remember, because I was in a crew called... So, subsequently from that, this is still 83, that's when one of the guys from the crew called Shuffle Master, we made a crew called Two-Way Shuffle.
Yeah.
And straight away, what happened was, we then heard or saw a video. We heard that people was busking down Covent Garden. And I think we heard of Sidewalk with Dolby and Michael Forsyth and all of them guys from there. And the way we actually heard about that was me and Chiddy then formed a crew called Two-Way Shuffle, but the rest of the guys in Groove Patrol weren't really breakers, they were poppers. And I'm not sure if they didn't have the physicality, I suppose they can tell you, but me and him, as soon as we saw it, we was in love with it. I was always very, very athletic.
Didn't you want to bring poppers into the crew though? So you'd have poppers and breakers?
No.
You just wanted to keep it as a like a
we was just crew. In the book. In this book.
Actually, we're in Covent Garden now, Colin, so this is quite a nice time to talk about this.
Well, listen, let me tell you something. This is why, when I think back historically about Covent Garden, me and Chiddy were a two-man band. We used to bust down Covent Garden together. It was just us two. And because my mind was very business orientated back then, to a fault, as far as I'm concerned, I never really wanted to be in a big crew. I always just wanted it to be us two, because there's less money to share around. So even if you look on this book is 1983, we had the best double caterpillar. We used to have a move where he would go, I would do belly on head. So my belly, I'd be laying flat on his head, he'd twist me on his head, he'd stand still, keep spinning me. We used to do King Tut, I'd go on his shoulders, we'd be doing King Tut, knocking his hand. I mean, we was a two-man wrecking crew. However, what you found was there was not many duos. I think the only other duo that I remember, and I'm sure people are going to correct me, the only other duo that I remember was Basil and Darnell, and they wasn't really even a duo. They got together for the electro rock show. They wasn't a duo, so there wasn't really any duos. It was always crews.
So you was probably like one of the first kind of duos, like two of you.
Well, the first duo that I know of.
Yeah.
It was just us two. So we used to busk down Cobham, hardcore. And when we would busk down Covent Garden, what you used to have to do was you used to have to book. People remember you used to have to book certain areas, and you had all of the performers down there that were jugglers and all this kind of stuff that would book up the areas first.
And did you have to pay someone to like busker?
In the main area, you did. But if you was very clever and smart, because you're talking about we're 13, 14, 15. We didn't have no money to pay nobody. So when people would, when it would die out, because if I remember rightly, you would only have to pay between a certain time. And then afterwards, it was kind of like, wasn't illegal, but you wasn't really supposed to be busking.
Yeah, but you just sort of got away with it.
You just sort of got, or you started doing it around the sides. And what people started gathering was, as soon as you started dancing and you had your stereo, you could just, people would start gathering, you got your hat there, and that would be it. So, I mean, I remember, you know, Ozzy's crew, who were main buskers down there. God, who was Dr. Stu. He used to have this this specific tape that he would, like, actually bus to. And the bit that I remember is, I know you're going to do this. He would do forward, he would do backward, he would do slow-mo. But loads of people were busking. I mean, loads. And I was busking down there, but I really wasn't part of the crew. I was part of making money.
Would you say that the people busking there, would you say they was mainly breaking and popping, or was it like a mixture of, like, you know, like clowns and like people doing magic stuff? Because I'm sure I remember when I went there, you used to see a few, like, magicians and...
You had all of that, yeah. You had loads of people doing different types of performances. And you have to think about it, right? Well, this is my perception. You see the guys that were doing the magic and illusions and juggling, these were, like, seasoned guys. What you would find is those guys that were doing the magic and illusions, these guys would be, like, all 17, 18, 17 upwards. Whereas the guys that were busking...
Little kids.
Little kids.
Yeah.
I was 13.
Yeah.
14, 15. 15 maximum. Busking. I would sometimes take home £150 for a weekend.
Which is, I mean, that's unbelievable money, isn't it?
I'm telling you.
I mean, what would that be like? That'd be about like 600, 700 quid now, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Not. Remember, you're talking about two of us.
Right.
When you started dancing in crews, that was different. That's why I never really liked dancing in crews.
Because you didn't get as much money?
You'd nowhere near enough money. And people would argue about money. I remember arguments about money.
Yeah.
My gosh, I can tell you some stories about money. So those are the days of the busking, and that's kind of how TNT then got formed, because...
Who started TNT?
I started TNT.
And what did TNT stand for?
TNT stood for The Nation's Top.
The Nation's Top?
Yeah. So...
The Nation's Top Rockers.
The Nation's Top Rockers. So, well... No, actually, let me scratch that. The person that really made up TNT was a guy called Mike Anthony. He's in Rampage. You know Rampage is a sound system? They are now on My Soul right now. And they've done Carnival for the last 20, 30 years. They're one of the biggest and most probably one of the best all-round sounds in England ever, my personal perception. So what happened was, we stopped doing two-way shuffle. And then what happened was, Michael created a crew called Star Jammers. And I don't know if he's going to ask, which he most probably will, he's going to go, oh my God. All right. Okay. So he made a crew called Star Jammers, right?
Yeah.
This would have been 84. When he formed this crew, and he wanted to do lots of different things with it. He just didn't want it to be a dance crew. I remember we went to a studio, we was going to do singing, and it was going to be a whole outfit. But he didn't want, he wanted set people to be in the outfit. And this is where my heart has always been. So I want, we had a pub, where this, where the book is taken, it's taken from some pictures in Grove Park. Now, when we used to go in Grove Park, just loads and loads of people used to hang there. So when they would hang there, I would imagine, right, I'd been on telly 82, so a lot of the guys around there all knew me as Colin, this dancer that had been on telly. So when we was down, I used to teach a lot of them and help them to dance. When Michael made up the crew Star Jammers, he only wanted it to be set people. I challenged him and said, hold up, no, I think we should have X amount of people in it. He didn't want them to be in it. So what subsequently happened was I left and formed TNT. Right. So even though I formed TNT, the credit really has to be given to Michael, because TNT was an offshoot of Star Jammers, which is the crew Mike Anthony created. So I'll always give him the credit for that. Subsequently from that, we had a battle with Mike Anthony's Star Jammers at Tiffany's. And at Tiffany's at them days was like the mecca, well, from my perspective, I've got to say, the mecca.
Where was Tiffany's?
It was in Wimbledon.
Right.
So there was two meccas. Lots of people would say the other mecca is Lyceum. People would say all different stuff. My mecca was Tiffany's. And in Tiffany's, you had London, Bionic from London, no, from London Posse. So he used to be in a crew called SAS. He used to go Tiffany's. You had Basil from Look Twice. He was used to go Tiffany's, because I remember nice to see him up there. You had Clive. You had Clive Taylor. You had one of the best dancers ever that was better than everybody then, a guy called Johnny Archer, who's living in Los Angeles now. He was most probably one of the best dancers. So we had a battle there. I believe we won. That's when TNT got formed, and the rest is history.
And how long did TNT run for? Like a couple years?
Well, no. We did TNT for quite a few years. I reckon we started in 84, and I think we finished about 89.
Colin, as influences, who was you looking up to as, as like an inspiration?
Funny you should say that.
And you could say as like individual and as a crew.
Okay, so as an individual, it was a guy called Paulie Paul. His name is Paul Ferguson. He is the person that created the crew SAS with all of those. I'll tell you who was in SAS, so you kind of get a context of who I'm talking about.
Is he the guy that you was with earlier?
Yes. Right. I was speaking to him yesterday.
Yeah, yeah.
And he made up a crew called SAS, which stands for Strawberry Art All-Stars. And in the crew was MC Mello. He was in SAS. Bionic. Basil. Doran.
Because Mello went under the name as Moomin, didn't he?
That's right. That's when he was popping.
Yeah.
And he was popping for SAS. When you do Easter, he'll most probably tell you about all of that stuff. But yeah, so he was definitely my inspiration, because what had happened was, if I went back to when I was in Ernest Bevin, they used to have this competition called the Metropolitan Police Disco Dancing Competition. Now this shows you how deep it was, right? So it was called that, and at the start when they created it, they never had a breakdance section. So what had happened was, I think it was the second one, well, I won the competition. They used to go around all the schools in London and then they would have a final. So I won the second ever competition. Because I had won it, they asked me to be a judge in the competition. When I was a judge, you had this guy called Paul Dacus from Jazz Theatre Company, and with KV. KV was part of that crew as well. He was a big time DJ. And so when we had that competition, because I won it, I was a judge, and that's when I met Paulie Paul. Paulie Paul was very inspirational because he was a bit older. He was maybe about 5-6 years older, very good popper, funk dancer, and he was really about spirituality, self-help, motivational speaking with everybody. He really tried to help the scene. But I think, I don't think nothing. He's just a legend. So he was the big butt for me.
So you'd say Ken Swift from Rocksteady was an inspiration as well?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
His style.
Yeah.
Because yes, he is a B-boy, but from my perspective, the way I always did my thing when it come to dance, I've always, when I first got into the whole hip-hop culture, it was always about doing it all. This is what, and I think somewhere along the line, I don't know what year, that got lost, but it never got lost to me. So far as I'm concerned, you had to be B-boy, DJ, graffiti,
MC.
MC. So I made sure I did them all. And I did do them all.
Right.
And as far as I'm concerned.
So you dabbled in a bit of graph as well then?
Yes, I was terrible. We did a piece, funny enough, I spoke to a guy, you've got to interview him, his name's Blemmer, right? I spoke to him, which I didn't, and he was in Born to Rock, further them guys, right? I can tell you about my, you know, link with Born to Rock, but he was in Born to Rock, and he said that he remembers seeing a piece that we did in Tooting Broadway. We did a massive piece that said TNT Rockers. It was there for years.
So what did you do that in, 84?
84, yeah, 100% 84.
Yeah.
I was thinking it was 83 or 84, it was 84.
84.
Yeah. Massive, he come out of Tooting Broadway tube station. We went there late at night. We had a guy called R.I.P. Dervis Johnson, who's not with us no more. He was an inspiration as well, actually, funny enough. Dervis, who was in our crew, because he was a bit older than us. And one of the things he showed us was about the spirit of fear. And he, from a very young, he used to talk about these acronyms, false evidence appearing real, with all this. And we would sometimes go to raves, to ragga raves, everyone would be dancing reggae, and he would ask someone to put on some hip hop. They would not put it on, and he'd go, because he used to have this American voice, right? He used to go, hey guys. Imagine, we're all 16, he's 19, 20, and he'd go, hey guys, I'm gonna do some breaking, man. And we'd be like, Dervis, you can't do breaking, there's man here that will chop us up. Nah, man, I don't care. And in a house party, this guy would do windmills, right?
No.
Yeah, Dervis.
Right, in the front room?
In the front room of a house. All my guys were like, he was something else. So he was an inspiration because he showed me, never be shy, never be scared, false evidence. So I'm not shy, I would perform anywhere, anytime. And I kind of got that from him and Paulie Paul. You know,
what style of breaker would you say you was, or would you say you was an all-round kind of
beat? Well,
because you had your power breakers, didn't you?
Yeah, well,
because I've seen a few bits and pieces of what you've done. You was very powerful as a dancer.
Well, you see now, here's the thing, right? This is what I listen, you have to think about it, right? You get some people, right, that evolved, and you got some people that never changed. So when it came to evolvement and change, I never really changed my style. So far as I was concerned, when I first started dancing, I've always seen myself as a dancer. I don't see myself as a b-boy. I don't see myself as a jazz dancer. I don't see myself as a popper. But as I got more and more into the scene, what I actually realized was people will pigeonhole you to be a b-boy, or to be a tricks man, or to be a power breaker. Far as I was concerned, I was an all-round dancer. And if ever in my mind, if ever anyone was going to battle me, they needed to be able to beat me. I used to say to myself, you need to be able to do it all. Because by the time we finished power breaking or tricks or whatever, I'm gonna go into some dancing. I might start popping. I might start jazz dancing. So when you're asking about my style is definitely all round. I do all round dancing.
Can we talk a little bit as well about the fashion? Because the fashion is just as important as anything else.
Absolutely.
So what was you wearing back then? Was you busting like the Kangols? And I suppose, let's go back to what was you wearing on the robot styles?
Robot?
Was you doing like the white gloves and all that?
About to say white gloves, black shirt, black trousers. But sometimes we had white shirt, black trousers. It was always kind of like very official, Well, and there's a, and do you know, funny enough, I've not been able to get that clip of Sunrise Festival 1983. And we was all there, white gloves, white shirt. So that was it. Basically taken from Tick and Tock.
Because, yeah. Colin, I remember when I used to do robot dancing back in 81 and 82 as well.
Yeah.
And I used to wear makeup to make myself look futuristic.
Yes, 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 yes. From Tick and Tock, because that's what they used to do, right?
That's this right,
the
way
they were supposed to be early 70s, or not early 70s,
late 70s.
Late 70s.
Early 80s.
Yeah, these, yeah. Did I ever do, no, I don't think we ever did the makeup thing. It was a bit shy from makeup and all of that, but
and you definitely done the white gloves.
Definitely did the white gloves, did the glasses as well. You know, the Tick and Tock glasses, which was the long panoramic glasses.
I had a pair of them, yeah. They come in different colours. Do you remember, like, yes, yellow and red and black? Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, so we did the panoramic glasses, so yeah.
And how about the B-boy, like the breaking fashion? What was you wearing then?
You see, when I did the B-boy...
Well, actually, you had the popping, because obviously you come robot, then the popping. So the popping fashion, was you wearing like the baggy trousers and like the gloves with the studs on?
Right, so here we go. Now, this was... Because I don't want to wait... I want to kind of get to the crux of the matter, right? Mm. But when we did TNT, I was never a popper. I used to... when we formed TNT, think of it like this, right? I was always a competent dancer. I formed a crew from absolutely nothing. So all of the guys in TNT really were kind of pupils. No one really knew that. All the people in TNT, I either taught them or they were just kind of learning when I'd been dancing already. So that was how TNT was. So in regard, what's the question you said? You said,
yeah, like the fashion. What was you wearing as a breaker?
Would okay.
You...
So when we was 15, we got our own costume made, our own tracksuit.
Did ya?
Yeah.
So what was it like?
It was like blue. We had white stripe there, white stripe there, white stripe on the trousers, TNT rockers on the back. So we had our own. And this was when we were 15. So before that, we was wearing tracksuits.
And was you wearing the boots, the Adidas boots or the Nikes?
Which ones was we wearing? Everyone wear different. So most of the crew would wear Puma. I used to have this exclusive pair of trainers, right? Called Adidas Breaker. I don't know if anyone's heard of them.
I've heard of them.
Do you?
Yeah, I did hear of them, yeah.
Patent Adidas trainers.
Yeah.
Very similar to these, actually. One of those. So Adidas Breaker, I remember having them. Nobody liked them. I don't know if anyone... I'd like to know if people heard of them, actually.
I know, I think I did hear of them, yeah.
Because when I used to wear them, I used to say, I thought everybody was going to get a pair. They came
and
out.
No one got them.
Nobody got them. It was like, what are those?
I can't remember what they looked like, but I remember the name of them.
Well, I was a Nike, so I used to wear Nike Air Force. So those were my trainers I used to wear, and then I got Adidas Breaker, but I always used to wear Nike. My friend, other friend, used to wear the Pumas. So it was really Nike or Puma, and Adidas, obviously. Did anyone wear anything else? I remember we used to have a guy, our crew, that used to wear Gola. I used to get run.
Gola, yeah.
He used to get run all the time, man.
Do you remember them?
Yeah.
And them trainers with the two-stripe.
Yeah. We had one guy get a couple of... bullying days, I do apologise, but yeah.
And the green flash.
The green, no.
no
green flash.
So let's go, where can we head now to, like?
Well, you can go to the swing, but you see, what happened was, I saw it as...
Because we're sort of up to, what, 85, 86 now?
85, 86, we did the whole TNT, well, so then what happened was, in regards to, you had DJ Richie Rich, if you remember him. So what happened
was he a manager?
Well, he became our manager, right? Because he used to DJ at a nightclub called Kisses. This is the, what's his name, Gordon, right? So he used to run, he used to be a DJ at Kisses, but he subsequently went on to run that radio station called Kisses, now subsequently runs My Soul. And Richie Rich was a DJ on there.
Was Richie Rich in Sidewalk?
Yeah, Richie Rich was in Sidewalk. The original member of Sidewalk.
Yeah.
So what happened was with all of those guys, Dolby, And big up to all of them guys, Michael Forsythe, legendary, because they was they wasn't most probably the first crew ever, but they was the first notoriety crew that got proper airwaves. So what happened was, when we used to go Kisses, one day we did a show down there, and Richie offered to be our manager. So I was like, come on guys, he's gonna be our manager. So that was it.
Now, where was Richie Rich from? Was he Southwest?
Do you know the funny thing? I don't even he's from. I don't know where he's from, actually. I think he used to live in North. No, he wasn't Southwest. It was definitely North London. I can't remember whereabouts. So he was our manager, and he kind of prepped us to be professional. So the other guys that were TNT, he and I was always about invoicing, be professional, all that kind of stuff. And he really, really schooled us, got us professional jobs. And as far as I was concerned from them days, even before, I was a professional dancer. So I was actually doing this for a living. So he got us loads of different shows, and subsequently I started like teaching other people. I had some dancers, and we got a contract with Polydor Records. And when we was working with Polydor, I met Stock from Stock, Aiken and Waterman, and they had a group called Pack Six. I used to do choreography for them. A lady called Vicky Lee, who was a page three model, and I did choreography for her. And I went on to do loads of different choreography jobs. This all kind of started from Richie Rich. And also, I choreographed Richie Rich's album. That was, 91, 90? Yeah, and the video's online, Feel It. So I was choreographing all of his album and some of his artists when he was working for that record label as well. So yeah, Richie Rich was kind of very inspirational to me, but also really kind of taught me the business side of it. And I subsequently carried on working with other artists, but just on the business side.
So
but,
how did you get into the swing beat?
Well, you see, now what happened, as far as I'm concerned, I remember when you had the video of Kid and Play, and I'll never forget it came on. And
is that when they got the flat tops and wearing the baggy trousers and the baggy shirts?
Right, so that comes on, and you've got a whole new, as far as people are concerned, a whole new breed of dancing. But yeah, you see, because of my jazz funk days, it was just, to me, it was just a different version of the jazz funk days.
It's quite natural.
Quite natural. Yeah. I didn't see it as no different, but because I think it never really had the core essentials of the hip hop, which is, you know, derived from the Bboying, breakdancing, graffiti and all of that. And people, the whole Bboying thing went underground, and a lot of the dancers stopped, went into producing. There's so many artists like DJ Swing was in a crew called Harlem Wizards, which we battled and beat, may I say. But anyway, he was in a crew called Harlem Wizards. So people like DJ Swing, people like Groove Rider, a lot of these guys were big time into the hip hop scene. And when that whole phenomenon came in, and when I say that, RIP, DJ Swing, even Ty as well, they were all really good dancers. Kosha, a lot of people were dancers. But when the whole swing beat thing came, a lot of people kind of backed off from the hip hop thing, and it was, well, from my perception, people would argue, it was almost seen as, this is something new, and if you get into all this whole swing beat thing, you're kind of being quite traitorous against your scene. So a lot of people never done it. But because I, at that time, was a professional dancer, to me, it was just another form of dance. So I carried on doing it. And subsequently, I went on, there was battles within that. So that whole scene had loads and loads of dancers, just like, you know, you've got very integral B-boys within it. You've had some of them here. You've got King, you've got Purvis, you've got Fraggle, you've got Dolby, you've got... But then, from the swing beat days, you've got this guy called Mo Ideas, Mark Welsh. They was in a crew called RPM Dancers. And all these different styles of that. So I went into that swing beat dance, but we went in as TNT. So TNT carried on dancing, but I had a whole new people, a lot of people that we that I taught up. And we did a performance at the Fridge 1992, that's on YouTube. And, you know, my brother was in it. I had Amanoir, who's now a famous poet. So what you're finding is people that were in the hip-hop days, the b-boying days, they all kind of branched off, carried on doing their thing, had the same love for it, but because it kind of was like a bit underground, they kind of stopped doing it. But I carried on dancing. So I was carried on dancing all those years, and then I'll never forget this, 1993, I was at a particular rave, and that's when I met Born to Rock.
Ah, right. Where did you meet?
Oh, I can't. They'll most probably. You've got to do an interview with them.
I'm going to be seeing them hopefully in the new year with Charlie and
good.
And ZR. And...
Right. So, because I think that when I actually. The funny thing was, when I was actually talking with Zia the other day, I thought Zia was in it way before me, but Zia joined Born to Rock roughly about the same time as me. So I think the first two people in Born to Rock was Spencer and Charlie. Those were the two that was in it. So what had happened was, they told me that they'd been b-boying, and they'd been b-boying for years, and I was like, going, don't lie. And they was doing, and Lee was someone that, when I first met him, Lee reminded me that I met him at Summer Art Festival 1982. So see, what I've never really done is I've always based my credibility on what I do now. So I could have gone in and said, and we've won a competition, which I posted to you, the NABC breakdance competition, was a national competition, 1984 was all the youth clubs in the country. We won that as TNT. So, but what I would say is, when I met Lee and those guys from Born to Rock, what I didn't do was go, oh yeah, guys, I'd been in the children's world variety show, plus I had done this, plus I'd done that. They didn't know.
Did they not know about you?
No, they did not know. They did not know at all.
I'm quite surprised, because I actually knew of TNT Rockers. I heard of them from back in the days, you know.
They might have heard of TNT Rockers.
But they didn't know. They didn't know
the background of TNT Rockers. Because, you see, if you think about the background of TNT Rockers, if you got a CV now of the dancers that were in TNT Rockers, much as I love them, most of them did two or three worth years of dancing. I've done 27 years of dancing. And more. So a lot of them though, so they knew of TNT Rockers, but they didn't know really that I was the teacher of TNT Rockers, and they didn't know that I carried on dancing. So when I met those guys, they were so passionate and hungry. I was like, oh my God, let me get somewhere. I was dancing with them, and then 1995, we found out that they told me that Germany was still having the breakdance championship. So I remember calling up, I did this, when they told me, I called up the guy called Thomas, his name's Thomas Hergenhaugen, I rang him, and I said, look, got a crew over here, we wanna come, and I got put in the competition, right? So I said, right, boys, we're gonna go over to Germany, we're gonna enter the competition. Cut a long story short, the only people that was able to go was me, Charlie, and we got Hulk, who used to be in Ozzy's crew.
Oh, the cover, yeah, he used to break down Covent Garden.
Yeah, he still does, I think. He's still busking, bad boy, right? Him and a guy that I used to dance with in TNT, his name's Gucci. So all four of us went to Germany with the, I shouldn't laugh, and think of it. So we had been dancing, those two had been dancing, I was dancing with them, and we was just passionate, we just wanted to go over there and rep. When we went over there, let me tell you something, I was so shocked at what I saw. I mean, it was live and kicking. 1995 UK, couple bits and pieces. When you go there, there was about 160 crews that entered. It was like in a place like...
Was it more like European, or was it crews just from like Germany or...
No, everywhere.
Like worldwide?
Worldwide.
Right.
Worldwide, you were mainly Europe, but there was people outside Europe that was entering. It was like massive competition. And the standard was, for them times, it was off the hook. So I remember seeing, and I remember walking in, and to be honest, going, like thinking, oh my goodness, wow, the scene. And then on the day, I think Melvin, I think he hurt his leg, Gucci Kunda, and then it was supposed to be just me and Spencer just dancing, and I was just like, I don't think it's worth us just getting up and repping. And I'll never forget that day because, you know, Charlie wanted to dance, and I kind of just said, I don't think we really should. We're not going to rep properly. And so enough respect to Charlie, boy. In fact, no, what am I talking about? He did go and dance. He went up, did a little thing, actually, but we didn't go and dance as a crew. Yeah.
And back in those, like, you know, mid-90s, who was repping it in UK? Who was keeping up that kind of B-boy sort of attitude?
Second to none.
So was it just second to none?
Second to none, Born to Rock.
They were the main two crews?
That I knew of.
Yeah, yeah.
I know there was more, because I heard afterwards there was guys up in Cardiff.
Because a lot of us come out of it and we moved on to different things, like the house music thing.
This is what I'm saying. People were doing different things.
The drum and bass, you know, all that kind of, you know.
But you see, what? This is why people, I've always encouraged people to say their own story, because you never know, right? All I'm saying is, from my perspective, I remember going to clubs, trying to break dance, and people going, nah, 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 nah. That's out now. What are you doing?
And they used to laugh at you.
Yeah.
I remember, do you remember that swing beat club called, it was in Legends on, old, I think it was on Burlington, old,
yes.
Burlington Street. Legends, is on a Wednesday night.
Yes, I went there, yeah.
And that was a swing beat night.
Yeah.
I think this is going back to the early 90s, I think, or mid 90s, I can't remember. But yeah, I used to see a few people like doing like the breaking moves in there.
You see, you needed to be a good dance, because if you just tried to go out tops, do top rock and go down and break in, people would disregard you because they would say, nah, that's out. So you needed to be skilled. So what I would always do was do my swing beat dancing and add in my popping and breaking. That's what I would do, because to me, swing beat was a mix between all of those. Whereas lots of people, because it never had the culture and the essence of what the whole hip hop culture stood for, people just said, not into it. Teddy Riley, all these guys, they're just about money, being flashy, and you had a whole new breed of people taking over. This is why now there's a real disparity with the young people that are dancing now, because I know there's a guy, what's his name? His name is, like, all these guys that are dancing now, like Boy Blue, and Flawless, these guys. Now, when you speak to the young dancers that are dancing now, they will tell you, say, who's an old school dancer? They will tell you, Flawless, Boy Blue, Size 9, these guys. And so there's a real kind of a gap lost. There's a missing link. And, you know, one day that's got to be fixed.
Well, hopefully with these kind of interviews, you know, we can fill in the details.
Absolutely.
That's the whole point of me doing this. Is so I can fill in the blanks.
Absolutely. So yeah, so I went on, did the whole, and then so that brings me on to when I was there in 1995. Then when I was there, Thomas introduced me to Hooch. I met Hooch there, and he told me...
Who's Hooch? Is he the guy from the UK B-Boy
Championship? Yeah, he's the guy from the UK Breakdance Championship,
right?
So, but he hadn't started it up there. So I met him there, and he told me he wanted to set one up in the UK. So I said, okay, cool. So when he came back, I met him a couple of times, and I remember promising him, said, don't worry, I know all the guys that are into UK B-boying and all that, I led to get them. So I subsequently went to the people that I know. I won't name who I went to, but trust me, I went to quite a few people. 95, 96, no one was interested. That's out. It's not going to sell. It's not going to do nothing. I know that for a fact, right? Because when Hooch came to me and told me he was going to do that competition, I went on a journey to try and get people for this competition. So subsequently, if you think about, if you look on 1996 when he did it in Hammersmith Palais,
was that the first one?
That was the first one.
That's a big venue to have your first, you know, your first jam.
This is what I'm saying, right?
So that's massive, isn't it?
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. So he did this, he did that competition. But before, just a little bit back, so about. Just have to say this, right? Because this has got to be done, because I've got the news clipping of this. There was a competition that was at Hammersmith Palais, and this is when I this is the elephant in the room, I'm going to call it. It's the difference and the spread between, and I'm going to mention it because no one doesn't mention it, between black and white. You're black, I'm white. And I'm sure you've noticed that, right? Good, so have I, right? Right? Now, let me tell you, it's an elephant in the room because I remember when I first was in Bboying, most of the B-boys were black, right? But you had white guys that were dancing as well. You had Darnell, you had Scotty, you had, and there was quite a few white guys that were dancing, but the main essence and the main people that were dancing were black, right? And second to none, for me, was the first all-white crew. And then I met, but until then, I'd seen black and white crews anyway.
Yeah, so, but the main reason for that is that's because of where they're from, isn't it? I mean, London, like...
Well, London is metropolitan, right?
Exactly,
So you should have been...
The further afield you get, the more...
Yes. So what happened was you had this competition at Hammersmith Palais, and it had loads of crews in it. You had Rock City, you had London All Stars, you had Street Machine, you had us TNT, you had
what year was this at?
This was 89.
Right. Oh, so them crews were still going then?
Yes, or 88, 89. I've got the clipping, right? So I can show it. So if anyone wants to question it, I've got the clipping. I put it online a couple of times. And I'll never forget this. This is the time when I saw a difference. Now, all of the crews up there that were in the 60s were all black. And you had one crew in it, and they were called, I don't know if you heard of them, they were called Street Machine.
Yeah.
Now, no one had heard of them. And I'll never forget this day because who was supposed to win? It was supposed to be, everyone said it was supposed to be rather London All Stars or Rock City, right? It was just out of them because nobody else was rated, right? Everything was just them because they, London All Stars, Dolby's crew had such a high rating. They had gone to America, they had done whatever they had done, and they were just up there. And you had Rock City that were from Nottingham or Birmingham, wherever they were from, with Tricks, you know, and they were just like off the hook as well. Yeah.
So is this not going back to like 84, 85? Because I thought it would have been around then. Yeah.
No, this was like 87.
Right. I didn't even realise that them crews were still doing all that then.
I've got the clip in, and I was 17 when we won that, when we came third in that competition.
Right.
So that would have been 17, that would have been 84, 85, 86, 87.
Yeah.
And this was a Hammersmith Palais. I've got the clip in, the news clipping of this, and the crew that won were Street Machine.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget it because they was not supposed to win. And second came Rock City, and we came third as TNT. Still got the clipping, as I'll say. Evidence. Right? And that was the first time I saw all white crew, and in that crew was Jason Orange. From Take That. He was actually in that crew.
He's meant to be a really good B-boy.
Oh man, they killed it that day. If I think back to that day, because I remember it like yesterday, it was the first time that I saw someone do, it wasn't the first person I've ever seen do the long head spins. It was the first time I'd seen someone do the bouncing turtle for so long and took the arm away. One of them did that. Jack Hammers, and he just went on and on. Spencer can do that, right? But this was early. They did that, and they just, everything that went, and they won the competition. And this is when I think the whole mixture of black, for me, is my perspective, where the mixture started coming in of black and white. Because I think until then it was kind of dominated by black dancers. My perspective. Anyway, jumping back now to the whole swing beat thing.
Everyone, jumping back to the swing beat era.
Jumping back to the swing beat era, this is when, then when this whole, when Hooch came in to do the breakdance championships, I went round, tried to get all the people that I knew was in break, didn't do it, rest is history, and he formed that competition. And that now competition is one of the biggest competition. There was a lot of people that had a major problem with Hooch for doing that competition because I think that people felt that he wasn't part of the scene or didn't know people, but he'd done what he did and the rest is legendary. And from that competition, that's when I... So, that's when I met Mr. Legendary, this is 97 or 98, John ZD. So I then did the competition, and Mo Ideas, who was from RPM Dancers, told me about John ZD. He told me he was doing this theatre competition. Not his theatre competition, his theatre show.
What was John ZD? Was he a B-boy?
He was initially, yeah. Because when we did some shows, I see him bust a couple windmills and that. So I think he was more of a rapper. But I think he definitely danced.
He dabbled in a bit of dance.
Oh yeah, he's a professional dancer. I mean, he can dance, like proper.
Yeah.
He's classically trained, proper dancer. And an actor, and all round. But yeah. Anyway, so this is like 97, 98. And, this is 97. 97, this is the year of the competition. And we did lyrical theatre. So lyrical theatre was, he did lyrical theatre. And I auditioned to be part of it. And again, I will say to you, that when I auditioned to be in lyrical theatre, the joke of it was, and Johnsy can see this now, was I actually knew who Johnsy was, but he didn't know who I was. And again, I didn't go, I am who's been on this. I auditioned as a dancer and got in. I got on the merit of my dancing because I've always actually done that. I've always tried to, don't look at me as this person that's done this and that. I'm a dancer. So I auditioned for that, done it, and I was in the crew with Banksy, Little Tim, Frank Wilson, John Z, who else, and wicked producers, the beat maker, Eric Bboying, and all of these guys. And we did lots and lots and lots of touring, different countries, and that stuff was lit. And interestingly enough, at that particular time, 97, 98, 99, it's about a 2-year period, I was about to give up dancing. So when the whole lyrical theatre thing came about, I then started the whole lease of life again. So I started dancing again, I was touring, and at that particular time when I did this is when I was doing lots of jobs. I ended up doing choreography for Beverley Night, George Michael, Skunk and Nancy, touring with this company, doing choreography for this and that. Because again, as far as I was concerned, I was a professional dancer. I didn't actually see it that I was just restricted to b-boying, even though my roots was b-boying. Because sometimes I used to talk to, and all of this time.
And Colin, yeah, it's quite sorry to interrupt. Sure. It's quite mad that you're a traditional dancer, but you haven't really, no one's really sort of taught you. You've sort of self-taught yourself by probably watching like video clips or, and just basically doing it.
Yeah, well, funny enough, I did do A-level dance at King's.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I did do I did do A-level dance at Kingsway Princeton, but I dropped out actually after the year because when I did it, I wasn't really feeling the course. And, you know, you had to do tap and a bit of jazz and all this, and I didn't really want to do that. I think I was a bit, I wish I would have actually completed it, because later in years, when I started touring with John Z and started doing a bit more contemporary dance.
I love the tap dance.
I wish I would have carried on doing that. So yeah. I didn't really do that. So lyrical theatre thing, that came up, and then I was touring, and then it came to a head in 1999 where I injured my knee, and I couldn't actually walk for about a year. This was 1999, and that subsequently...
Did you injure it through dancing?
Yep, I injured it through dancing, and I subsequently stopped dancing for quite a bit. But all the time that I was doing that, I was always a youth worker. So remember when I was telling you about my early days, when I was kind of a bit of a bully and all of that kind of
stuff. Yeah, yeah.
I got community service at a young age, and all of that time I was always doing youth work.
Mm.
And then subsequently, when I was toying with John Z and doing a lot of different stuff there, I was managing the children's home, and I started doing child work and working with children, young people that had been abused and had been in care, and doing lots of stuff around self-esteem and self-development.
And so that must have been a massive eye-opener. That must have sort of changed your life in a way.
It did, because you know it put me in a position where, you see, I think when a lot of us dance, it's about expression, right? It's about expression of self. And what kind of happens with a lot of people is, depending on your background and depending on what has happened to you within your life, will depend on how you express your dance. So you will find that some people are power breakers are not power breakers by accident. They normally, if you look at their characters, the characters are quite powerful as well. And you will find that the creative dancers who go into are more creative. This is my personal perception of it. But when I was working with a lot of the young people, what I found was that I was kind of selfless. So lots of the dance crews that I've joined has always been about teaching. So, you know, I'm a qualified teacher, I've been teaching for years, I've taught dance, I teach in my children's home, and many times when I've been on telly and stuff like that, and I've gone back to the children's home, it always would be funny. Like when I did the George Michael show, when we did the George Michael, this was Net A 2000, King B was in it, Power Breaker, you had Paul Farquharson in it, you had Tim, Little Tim, Big Time, you had Frank Wilson, you had loads of people in it. And when I finished that, I went back to my children's home and they saw it. It was like they saw, you know, I was the choreographer for that show, 10,000 people, Wembley. And the young people, I remember saying, why are you working here? Why are you coming? Why don't you go and do that? And this time, you got most of them dancers who are still dancing now, touring the world, and I'd go back because my real love was working with the young people. That's why I still do it.
Yeah, yeah.
So I really tried to juggle it. I tried to do both. I still try and do both now.
That's more important than anything, isn't it?
Absolutely. So that was like 99, 2000. And then, I'm gonna show you something. I bought something here, because I was gonna say something, right? But I thought, we call this in my workplace, it's called evidence-based practice. So I just didn't want to talk about it. It's one of my proudest moments, what I did with young people. So I had a group of young people that got into a lot of trouble. And I remember saying to them that they can do anything, and they said, we can't, and it was quite good rapping. I said, right, do you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna do a...
Oh, is this the Guinness Book of Records? Oh, you bought that?
Let me
pull over, one sec. Let me pull over.
Just for...
Hold on, turn it the other way up. Can you go zoom right into the camera? Go a little bit closer. That's it. Leave it there for a sec.
Yeah.
So certified the longest freestyle rap by a team lasted for 10 hours, 2 minutes, and yes, was achieved by the Tooting Hub Youth Centre, UK in London, on the 31st of March 2012.
Yes.
10 hours, 2 minutes.
Yes.
Of rapping freestyle.
Yes.
So how many of you... Was you involved with the MCing as well?
Yeah, of course.
And how many of you were...
10.
There was 10 of you?
10 of us.
So that's literally like just over an hour.
Yep.
Each person.
Yep.
And it was continuous.
Continuous.
That's...
And the DJ for that, and I made sure there was a reason why I did this, the DJ for that, part of it, was DJ 279 from Choice FM.
He was playing the beats?
He was playing some of them, yeah. He played, he couldn't play for 12, for 10 hours.
Yeah.
So he DJ'd for some of it, I DJ'd for some of it. DJ DTS, Tony Spordin, he was another DJ for it. Was DJ Houdini? Anyway, I think he was DJing for it. So we had a couple of people, and we had Raph, I've got mentioning Raphael, and he did drumming, so we had live drumming for it as well. We had to pay for it. So what the young people did was I got them together, they formed a crew, a team, and we had to do funding for it. We had to get video, we got this company to video record it. We had to pay for solicitors to be there to be the officiators, and we had to pay for Guinness World Record to be there. So to actually do the record, they had to write out a business plan and how they was going to do it. So I sat with them, got the money, and we did it. They came, we had Guinness World Records there watching. We had to video it, and then subsequently they gave us, and it took ages for them to actually give us the record, because one of the stipulations is that there mustn't be a break for more than 2 seconds. Yeah, so we did that. I think it took about four or five months for them to get back to us to tell us that they had all done the record, and it was something I really achieved with them. So even though I've done loads and loads of things, it was one of my proudest moments because I actually done it with the young people, and they didn't know I could rap. I mean, I'm not of the best, but I can freestyle rap for as ever long anyone wants. It's not a problem, right? Because I'm quite confident. So yeah, so that took us up to 2012.
That's a big achievement. Was you in the film Human Traffic?
Oh yeah.
I think, did you leave that bit out? When was that?
That was...
When did that come out? I can't even remember.
God, what did I think that was... 2000.
And what was you doing in Human Traffic?
I was a dancer in it. So I was in it with, that was, because my little buddy, that was Tim, that was Little Tim, that was me, Little Tim, Mark, Frank Wilson. Yeah. And that was fun, actually. That was fun. Because that film went on to be kind of a cult classic. He was the star of the film, basically.
Right.
Johnson. And then you had the guy that's now, I'm terrible with names, but he's now in EastEnders. Who's the guy that owns the pub?
Oh, what's his name? The crafty Cockney geezer.
Yeah.
Oh God.
Anyway, him.
I don't watch EastEnders, but
right.
I know who you're on about.
That guy. He was in Human Traffic.
Danny Dyer.
His first ever film was in Human Traffic.
Did you get to meet him?
Yeah. He got to meet all of them. Yeah.
Colin, listen, right. Out of all your dance styles, which one would you say you were sort of best at? Would you say you're just good at all of it?
I'd most probably have to say the best, the one that I was the swing beat.
You love the swing beat style?
Oh, no, you said which I was best
at.
One that I loved the best was Bboying.
Yeah.
By far. Bboying was my ish. I mean, I practiced so much at Bboying, it was scary. I mean, I used to practice 4 or 5 times a week.
Did you used to train as well? Did you used to do like an exercise, like press-ups and...
All of that stuff. I used to do handstand press-ups on the wall.
You done press-ups against the wall?
I used to have to do handstand press-ups without the wall.
But without the wall?
Yeah, with no wall.
No wall.
Yeah.
No wall press-ups.
Yeah. I used to practice that because to be powerful, you used to have to do press-ups and
sit-ups. Yeah.
So I used to train a lot.
Yeah.
Not fitness training, but because I used to attach it with the whole kung fu films, you know, the late night and all of that. So when you look at them kung fu films, they'd be like, hold this, hold this for 2 hours and hold that. So I used to, my little brother, God bless him, mental height, Floyd, I mean, he was incredible for his age. I mean, arguably, he was the second best in TNT and he was 8. And I used to practice him like Floyd, practice, you're my brother,
like cracking the whip.
Yeah, and he used to be really, really, really good. I mean, he was at a very young age, arguably, he was as good as me. He wouldn't even most probably agree because he isn't as bulky as me, but he was very, very good. And to this day, he's very good, but he's very humble and he's a bit shy, so he doesn't go out there. But if you push him in the wrong way, then he'll battle. But he didn't really have that many battles because he wasn't really like that. He was very much, he learned from me, and he was like a professional dancer. So I got to a stage when I was quite young where I was like, I'm above battling. Not that I didn't ever battle, but it was always about the money. Or about the show. Or about auditions, or about this, and then that's what I'll show you. So yeah, I'd say the one I was best at definitely was swing beat, because you see, with the swing beat, I think that was where I had the most advantage. The b-boying, I think I had a bit of an advantage as well. But what I found with the b-boying was that it was very, very subjective, because you had, like, as you've had King on here, he could say he was the best. Pervez could say he was the best. Dolby could say he was the best. This one would say he was the best. But with swing beat, it was an amalgamation of lots of different styles, whereas Bboying wasn't. It was very, very, very focused on Bboying. There was a specific way you had to do it. You had to be able to do your tops, you had to be able to dance, you had to be able to do power, you had to be able to do style and all of that. But the swing bee, I feel within myself that I had a major league advantage on a lot of them guys that used to dance at the swing beat.
Yeah.
People like Paul Huggins, Mikey, even someone like, I don't know if you've heard of a DJ called Master Steps. He used to dance swing, but he was wicked as well.
Yeah.
So you had to, I think even Pervers used to do a bit. And King, both of those two, Pervers and King, used
to do a bit of swing.
Yeah. Definitely. I don't know how much.
Probably not much, but probably maybe dabbled.
Yeah, they dabbled because they were dancers.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
you had quite a few people that danced as well, swing beat, but I think I had quite a major league advantage.
And out of all the dance moves, was there, because I've always said when I used to try to learn breaking, the hardest move for me was called the caterpillar move, where you jump up in the air,
yeah,
you come down and then you'd roll back like that.
Well, if you look in that book,
I think Purvis used to say he called it the dolphin move.
Look in that book, me and Shuffle Master used to do the double caterpillar, right? And we used to do...
Oh, was that when you link up like that?
That's when we link up. That was 1983, 84.
Mm, yeah.
And my partner, to this day, I will say this, he was most probably the best at caterpillar to this day. So he was able to step from a standing position, go down and do caterpillar.
And it could go both ways as well, couldn't it?
Yes, but he could do it from standing, because that was the hardest thing to do when you're talking about caterpillar. So what was the hardest move to do, or what was my best move?
You know, did you have like a problem with like doing your first windmills, or?
Oh my God.
Because I remember trying to do my first windmill and it was like a nightmare. I couldn't do it.
Well,
it took me, must have been months and months to try and learn that move.
And well, you see, the first person that I ever saw do windmills was a guy called Mark Witter. He's very good friends. Well, I don't know if he's very good friends, but I know Dolby knows him as well. And he was the first person I ever saw do windmills live. Now, I had seen it on telly, and the second person I ever saw do windmills live was my partner Chidi. So I didn't actually see me, and then it was me. So I didn't actually get, and it took us months. I reckon about 3-4 months to do windmills. Because unlike now, everyone can do long head spins, everyone can do windmills. But when I was learning it, I hadn't seen no one do it live. So you're finding that, because, you know, when you're kind of like, you're one of the first, you're a pioneer of something, and you're trying to, you haven't seen no one do it, except on telly. So it wasn't like we was a pioneer the first, but you hadn't got to see someone, no one couldn't tell you how to do it. I think windmill was, yeah, definitely. But the reason why I got my name two-way was because I learned how to do windmills both ways. Now,
right.
Now you don't see many people doing that now, but it was kind of difficult. But I learned that.
Because the moves they're doing nowadays are like, they're unbelievable, aren't they?
Oh, I mean, different level.
Totally different level.
It's total different level. And you see, and then you've got, when I think about what you had then to what you had now, people was adding a bit of pepper, salt to it. So when you think of like people like Ken Swift, he would always say, you have to do things both ways. That's why I remember him, because when people was first doing shuffle and footwork, it would always be that people would just go around one way. It would always be that. Or when I was first learning to DJ, because I was a very competent DJ as well. And just to tell you, right, how competent I was at DJing, just so you know, there was a DJ called, used to come to my house. So the history of it is, there was a guy called Jason Gardner, and he used to be, this was like most probably 86, where he would be cutting and scratching. And I went round his house at the day of Bboying and learned how to cut and scratch as well. I got my 1210s and I used to be proper into cutting and scratching, watching the whole Jazzy Jeff and Cash Money and all that kind of stuff. And I taught this guy called Defcon 1. Mm. He used to come round my house, and he subsequently went on to be Derek B's DJ.
Yep.
And he was very, very, very good. Even if you, you know, Pogo's going to watch this, right? And I don't know how good he rates DEFCON 1, but he was very, very, very good.
Yeah.
I don't think he was good as them guys.
No.
But he was definitely, but he was up there with them, you know, because you're talking about...
He was rated.
He was definitely up there with them. Like, but I think he, because you see, the whole thing about performance in regards to getting somewhere and getting notoriety is not just about how good you are. Because if you, I think if it was just on skill for skill, he could match anybody. But it's not about that. It's about, can you do it when the lights are there? So when it came to a competition, could you hold your nerve and do it? Just like any other sport. So I think he was good. And I was better than him at one stage because I taught him. But could I have held my name and my nerve in the DJing? Not really. But, I was a very competent DJ.
Yeah. I'm going to say to you, actually, talking about music, what music used to get you hyped up back in the B-boy days, the breaking
White Lines.
Was White Lines your tune?
Yeah, that was my tune. Or Breaker's Revenge.
Breaker's Revenge.
Breaker's Revenge. White Lines. Hip Hop Bebop. Man Parish.
Man Parish, yeah.
Oh my god, that used to be. That was for the popping though.
Oh yeah, that was a popping tune, wasn't it?
Popping tune.
How about Scorpio, Grandmaster Flash?
We did a show to that.
Yeah.
We did a show to that, Scorpio. Yeah. All of them. Yeah.
So, Colin, we're going to have to round it up soon, my man.
Cool.
But listen, tell me what you're up to nowadays as well.
So, I've got a T-shirt on here. As you can see, it's called Each Teach. Each Teach, that's my company.
Yeah.
And we're about to launch a radio station, Each Teach radio station. And what really I'm doing is all about motivational speaking, getting and inspiring young people. Because at the moment, I still work with young people. I manage a children's home. And I've done consultancy to help set up children's home. Because I really love youth and I work with them. But I try to do it in a creative way. Addressing young people's needs, but trying to do what they want to do, kind of balancing out the wants versus needs. So that's what we're doing. Got the radio station coming up, trying to put some young people on there, as well as adults. And I'm most probably gonna approach you, Steve, because I'm gonna get one of my people to come and interview you.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I love to do I don't like to say interviews, but a chat. Yeah,
absolutely.
Like a little
chat.
Yeah. Talking about youth, can you give me can you give a message to our youth, like some kind of positive message?
Yeah, because there's tons. I mean, if you believe it, you can achieve it. And with the young people that I work with that done the world record, that is just such a message to give out to all of the young people, because it's not that you can just achieve something. You can achieve something that is worldwide. So these are young people that were in trouble that we've got to do a world record. One of them has got his own company now. Another one's got a record coming out. So they're all doing big things. And these were young people that were on a kind of a bad track. So I'm always, I'm always saying each... Teach,
which each comes, teach,
each teach.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That's come from the words that we all must help young people to try and thrive, to try and progress. And this is why that what you're doing, Steve, I'm really rating it, because I mean, you're not a professional.
No, I'm just a cab driver. That's
you're just doing your thing, but at the same time, what you are doing is you are opening up doors for young people, you are opening up people for old school people as well. Because one of the things I would say to you is, even all the stuff I've done, and there's lots more that I've done, not many people have wanted to interview me, or not many people have. I haven't seen King B, Purvis B had that many interviews, but as soon as you get to be a rapper, everybody wants to interview you. So it's just about inspiring.
Yeah, what people need to understand is what hip hop is.
Absolutely.
And hip hop isn't about someone chatting on a mic. Hip hop is a culture.
Absolutely.
And what hip hop connects is obviously the breaking, the b-boying, the b-girling, the MCing, the graffiti, the beatboxing, style and fashion, knowledge.
Absolutely.
Well, I think we've got something else missing from that.
Let me give you my own swift to it, because I'm not, because I hear that what you're saying and I agree with all of that. But one thing I remember someone told me about hip hop, and I said, let me tell you something, I'm not into hip hop and I'm not into it. Hip hop is in me, and I try and say that to them.
Yeah, that's a really good way to look at
it. I don't have to go searching for it, it's here. So that's why you find some people lose their way, because they go around trying to find where hip hop is. Oh, there's hip hop. Mm. This is why some people don't see me at hip hop race, because I don't need to go nowhere. No matter where I go, it's in me. I studied it too long, too hard, and too brassly for it ever to leave me. So I would say my message to young people is to remember the diamond is within. And if you are really into hip hop, you don't need to look for it. It's here, no matter where you are.
It's inside you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And that's a great way to look at it. Right, Colin, we're gonna have to give some shout outs.
Shout outs.
We need some shout outs to anyone past and present. So,
So past. Big up to Dervis Johnson, RIP, my inspiration. Big up to Paul Farquharson, the creator of Strawberry All Stars. He's the creator of, you know, the Old Men Grooving? They're out now, doing the big thing. He's the creator of that group.
Right.
So big up to him, because he's always been a creator. Big up to all the crews talking about London All Stars, Dolby, Pervert. Big RIP specialty. Big up to
RIP to Sipo as well.
RIP to Sipo, Basil, Clive, all of them guys. Big up to John Z doing his thing. Big up to Hooch as well. Big up to Freestyle Fanatics, who I brought over that time. 97. Big up to you guys. Big up to my boys. Born to Rock. When I was dancing with them, enough love for them. Big up to Imperial Steps. Isaac used to be a swing beat dancer. He's got to come up and do one. Big up to Blemma, B-Boy, Little Tim, my boy Frank. Big up to my brother Floyd, Cyclops Junior. Big up to you. Big up to Colt 45.
Yeah.
Used to dance with him as well. Bevan didn't even get a chance to talk about him. Nicholas, their crew, and all of his barbecues. Big up to that. Big up to Mello. Big up to Sparky. Big up to Pogo. Cutmaster Swift. God, the list goes on. Big up to my wife.
Don't forget your missus.
Rashida, Misha, Ananea, my children, because they're my family. Big up all the young people I've worked with, because talking about DJ TS, Houdini, you're talking about Aisha, all of those guys that did the world record with me, my young people, my passion, I'll always be for them. Big up all
But we can go on for a long time.
Big up to you as well, Steve. And don't forget your book.
Listen, Colin.
Where is it? I'm advocate.
Don't forget that. I'm going to come round and get that soon.
Yeah, that's for you.
Listen, it was a real honour to have you in the back of the cab. I hope you felt quite relaxed.
Of course.
It seemed like you really enjoyed it as well, which is good.
I enjoyed talking. I told you already, I enjoyed talking.
And you know, I've learned a few bits and pieces there as well, and it's been great.
Absolutely.
Really great, and an absolute honour to have you in the cab.
The honour's all mine, my friend. Honour's all mine.
Absolute honour.
That's why I hunted this book down for you. I've got my own, but this one's for
Listen,
you.
We're going to have to get you to sign that as well.
Cool.
I've got a pen. I've got a pen in the cab here.
Cool.
I've got a marker. But listen, Colin, absolute honour, all right?
No problem.
And thanks for coming on the and also anybody watching this, subscribe to this YouTube channel, because we're trying to bring the history.
Absolutely.
So the more and more people that spread, you know, like share this video link, the more and more people get to know what, you know, obviously find out history about, you know, like yourself. Get a little close up.
That's Benito, the guy you interviewed.
Yeah. I won't say his writing name, but that's
cool.
But yeah, no, nice one, Colin.
All right, man.
All right, make sure you got everything as well.
I've got everything.
All right, my man. Peace and love.
All right,
you
man.
Me.
Cool.